Parental discretion is advised.
Find yourself in the Beachview area of Pittsburgh? Check out the official pizza of this show, Slice on Broadway, sharing an abnormal obsession with pizza we can relate to. Check them out at sliceonbroadway.com and tell them this show sent you. The road to 500 is long. It is Wrestling Mayhem Show 498. I'm at Sorgatron. Mike Sorg here in the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA. Ready to rock your faces off with mediocre professional wrestling. Ha! Let's get into it. Of course, with me, it is Bobby F. Birthday Town. It's Bobby F. J. Town. How you doing, sir?
I am doing great. I'm in the new key demographic, but I got some breaking news from the authority. We cannot start this podcast unless Roman Reigns can defeat Sheamus in 5 minutes and 15 seconds. So we're going to have to wait at least that long to find out.
Yes, we all have challenges, and the man that's going to be tasked with talking no more about how the Wyatts are misbooked for 5 minutes and 15 seconds, it is Mad Mike from Poughkeepsie, New York.
I still think Sister Abigail might be Undertaker's mother.
Fear is abound!
She also may be the mother of Dudleys.
There's another
Dudleys or dragons.
There's another Dudley question we'll have to talk about at another point.
Dragons of Dudleys, Bobby. Dragons of Dudleys.
Why is Jesse Sorensen from Dudleyville all of a sudden in NXT? What happened there? did anybody else catch that? What the?
Sorg. He got hit in the head way too many times.
What happened? Him or the announcers? What? Although, also with us in this first segment, we're going to do a little bit of switch-ups today, but he is the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling. He is Eamon Payton. Join us from San Antonio, Texas. Eamon, too, please, on the Twitters, and also my co-host for the Indie Mayhem Show.
Yes, indeed, Sorgatron. I'm excited to be back once again on the main show. The first week I've actually watched like all of Raw, pretty much all of Raw. In a long time, so I've got things to say.
Man, I was there and I didn't watch all of Raw. But anyways, this is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. No, I didn't. I didn't leave the suite for the entire duration of Raw for some reason.
I didn't leave the suite.
I didn't leave the suite.
Excuse me, Mr. Hoity Toity.
This is first world problems.
There's not enough cocktail sauce in my suite.
We'll touch on that.
Mister, I bought a video game that was found by pigs that dig for truffles.
What?
Mister,
listen to Boss Battle for the explanation of that.
My ass.
Listen to Boss Battle for the explanation of that.
Anyway, this is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. We're finally hitting big time here on the road to 500. You check out everything at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Past episodes, past interviews with such names as, Krista Joseph of Lucha Underground, DJ Zima Ion of TNA, Mr. Raymond Rowe and Cedric Alexander of Ring of Honor, if you can find them on TV these days like Mike can't. They're all on there. Just look up all those names. We got a lot of talks, even from back in the day. I apologize for the audio quality 5 years ago. Over at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to this show on the iTunes. Leave a comment on the iTunes. Even if you're not even on the iTunes, please leave a comment and star rating. It helps us so much. Or on the YouTubes, on the iHeartRadio, Stitcher, Spreaker, all over the place. Audio, video formats, Daily Motion. There's a little bit of clips over there, too. You can follow us, Mayhem Show, on the Twitters, Wrestling Mayhem Show on the Facebook group where we have a lot of discussion. You can join us right here at 9 p.m. Eastern Time at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, just like our friends in the chat room, which include Wheels, Juggalo John, some guy named Hugh, Buddy, and Brother Sorg. And also, you can join us on the Patreon, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. People are putting their hard-earned money where our mayhem mouths are, and we appreciate it. And you don't have to do this. Even just share the show. We appreciate any way helping to get the mayhem out there and share it and everything. Please go check it out. And thank you to our Patreons this week, including Bo Diggity. Woo! Bezos every week so I can say his name like that. And of course, our friend Antonio Garza, the man who gets the name straight in the Lucha Underground and Midweek War, and also representative of the WrestlingRevolution.com. Please go check out their site, as well as Ed Burke. has been joining us, and the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment, all friends of the Mayhem Show. Hey, if you guys kick $5 an episode, you guys kick $5 an episode, you can put that on a resume for as long as you're doing that, and we will back you up. And also, after about a month of being an EP, we will send you Wrestling Mayhem Show's executive producer business cards like we have for our friends over on Awesome Gas. So I encourage you guys in that as well. So
And by the letter Q and the number 7.
What?
And people like you.
And people Thank like you. You, Mayhemers. So what is happening? Oh, I see that on the Twitter. Some people are watching this show from their lavish suites as well as one mainstream Matt is as well.
Oh, look at him with all the fancy plastic cages for all of his wrestling figures.
Ooh.
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't know.
something highfalutin, because I like saying the word highfalutin.
And chinchilla furred.
No, that's a different show.
Hamsters. I don't know.
What were we even talking about anymore?
Well, this went great.
Well, that was a diversion. So, anyways, like I said, a few of us. I was in a suite last night for Monday Night Raw.
Ooh.
Somebody who's a friend of the show that works for a law firm that happens to get some sweet tickets. Sweet tickets. We didn't get any food or anything. It's no caviar. It's just I got a place to sit.
Aww.
That's not amongst
the food.
Other than
the platypus pack.
So you get food in the suite. Oh.
Kelbot, there was
we actually ate unicorn.
Hashtag thanks Obama.
The New Day supplied us with unicorn to eat. Try the narwhal.
Bye, buddy. Hope
I saw new areas of the console energy center that I hadn't before. It was pretty fantastic. But anyways, hanging out with Chachi there and actually running into some other friends of the show, not friends of the show, originators of the show, co-hosts of the show, Arevity, Shad, and Mayhem Missy.
Wait, did you see Doc Remedy, or did you see the man who murdered Doc Remedy and assumed his identity?
I don't know anymore.
Shit.
But no, it was good to catch up with everybody, watch the show, which I thought was a fun show, at least in person. Now, and the big question I thought, like, it felt like the rest of the roster was lost on a bus somewhere. So we had to double everybody up into this ridiculous main event, half an hour, too many people in the match thing.
Yeah.
What? I mean, I, and there's news. There's news. You guys were telling me, what happened to the rating last night? Or that was in the Slack, wasn't it? I'm sorry, that was none of
that
you
was
guys.
That was none of you guys.
Why Kevin Owens wasn't there?
But yeah, no. So yeah, then we're like, where's Kevin Owens? It doesn't make sense. You know, but Kevin Owens, you're saying, was down with illness, right?
Yeah. We found out. Via the dirt sheets, his son and himself were sick, so they had to actually go home. They kind of forced him home because he was really sick.
Oh geez,
so that's why he wasn't on the Raw.
Oh geez, so there's that, and also and at that point, WWE apparently reporting the worst rated Raw since before the Attitude Era. Hmm. Wow. And we got to witness it here in Pittsburgh. And it felt like as far as Pittsburgh goes,
you get that honor.
We get that honor, right? Right. We're the guys that booed Batista out of wrestling and we got this.
You got the Taker Mankind on the cell, you got the boo Batista, and you get the worst rated Raw. So you get
Rey Mysterio won't even come to Pittsburgh anymore.
Nope. But it is interesting because I thought they did a lot. Tommy Dreamer was a honest surprise, a nice surprise last night. It blew our minds when we saw him come out there. And they actually did their dark match was actually just, it wasn't even a match. It was just a scuffle between them, Kane, and the Wyatts, actually. So, I mean, that was really good for the Pittsburgh crowd. Yeah. I thought the crowd was great. I don't know how it came off on TV, but they seemed energized most of the night. I only heard a boring chant when we were in that main event match that went too long, which, really? Let's be honest, I would have been chanting it at home.
I was proud of Pittsburgh.
Mm-hmm.
They were chanting Tyler's Gorgeous.
Yes.
They were chanting like things you'd hear on NXT.
The ratchet chant for Sasha.
Like good. Yeah, good chants from NXT.
Yeah.
Not the latest chants that have been terrible.
No, I thought it was really good. I thought the show was doing really well. Again, until that main event. And even what we're talking about here before the show, Foley had some comments, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, these the comments he made were actually from last week's show, mm-hmm. but they kind of spilled over into obviously the ones this past week. I actually pulled up the Facebook post he made. It's fairly short. I'm just going to run through some parts of it. He says, I'm going to quote an article from July of 2014 called "The Sad Case of Zack Ryder," in which I wrote, quote, "Eventually people will get tired of finding out that the WWE superstars they have supported with their cheers, their signs, their purchases, their follows, and their likes aren't real superstars, and little by little those fans lose interest in WWE, find other interests, and become former WWE fans. I am one of those people on the verge of becoming a former WWE fan. I'm tired of being told through Raw, SmackDown, and pay-per-views that superstars that I've rooted for, from Ziggler to Cesaro to Kevin Owens, aren't really top stars, no matter how strongly crowd reactions seem to disagree." He goes on to say, 6 months ago, my son and I traveled 12 hours from Eastern Tennessee to Orlando to watch Sasha Banks wrestle Becky Lynch at NXT TakeOver, one of the greatest women's matches of all time. Last night, in what I believe was their first singles match on Raw, Sasha and Becky were given 4 minutes. At a time where WWE desperately needs to make new stars, when they need to give wrestlers with talent the opportunity to break through, they gave Sasha and Becky 4 minutes. And he kind of goes on from there. And I think it kind of I sympathize with a lot of his points is the fact that, you know, they're in a period now where so many of their top stars are gone for whatever reason, to where they desperately need to make new stars. And it takes work, and it takes actual, you know, more than just sort of, you know, putting them on your show to kind of make them seem important and make them feel like big deals. And while I think in aspects they're trying that in certain ways, like I feel like WWE is kind of just trying to, you know, truck on until Cena comes back, or they can get Taker back, or, mm-hmm. or you know, or they can get somebody that like they can, you know, rely on.
Well, even last night there was an announcement. I don't know if this got out there, but the, you know, the next show announcement was Brock Lesnar will be there on March 14th at Raw in Pittsburgh, and they were trying to sell push tickets for that. I thought it was mostly well attended. The arena seemed mostly full. A lot of the upper deck, of course, tapered off. You know, I'd say 2/3 of the available upper deck, not counting the, you know, the space. and everything. Sorry, there's some comments about last thing I'm going to try to share here in a moment from Twitter. I thought they did well there, especially with the pitiful performance that the house show did over the summer. That looked just sad in comparison in that house. It's definitely also, are we going to see this reflect in their financials? I think that's where you'll start actually seeing something happen. Is when we get that call from Vince and down across the board, you know, everything has been, you know, like we've talked about in recent weeks. Hey, more people are watching on TV. Maybe just not as people are watching on Monday night where the ratings matter, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know. I don't know what to say. How do you guys feel? Now, again, not in, you know, try to not be in a world where you are wrestling fans of things that are amazingly NXT and Lucha Underground. As just a WWE fan, how do you guys feel Raw has been typically lately?
Well, the thing is, like, we talk about how good NXT and Lucha Underground are. And a lot of people think they know the reason why, but I think they're kind of wrong. Like, why would you guys say you enjoy NXT and Lucha more than the rest of the product?
I think just the thing we say a lot is just storytelling. And you know, character development and stuff like that.
Yeah, because I think a lot of people will say, oh, well, they have really good matches on NXT and Lucha. I'm like, yeah, they do, but they have really good matches on ROH. Impact, the in-ring product, is generally very good. It's, they take, Lucha and NXT take the time to establish character motivations. Like, honestly, one of my favorite segments, I had two favorite segments last night. I wasn't able to join you guys in the hangout and the wrap up because I was at work. But I loved the Charlotte Becky Lynch match.
Yep.
And the Stardust Titus O'Neil segment.
Yeah.
Like, stories, backstage segments, character motivations. Like, why did Sheamus suddenly decide he needed six guys to be his backup when Alberto Del Rio wasn't even anywhere close to this last week? Was this supposed to be Kevin Owens? I think it might have been, but Kevin Owens was sick.
I'm with you. I can completely see that, especially since Ambrose was on the other side of the ring.
I think Kevin Owens absolutely. Is from Montreal.
Yeah, Montreal, which isn't even Canada practically.
But you look at the differences between those two and say I'm not going to say like exactly this would happen in NXT, but in NXT, this would build a bit. You know, Sheamus maybe would, you know, have some conversations with like a Barrett or a Rusev or a Del Rio or something like that, and then sort of plant seeds of you know, them possibly joining up together. They just joined it together in 1 week, and it reads like, okay, we have to scramble for something.
Another thing that NXT has a benefit of, though, is it's taped all at once. Like, 4 weeks of TV are taped all at once. And Raw is basically rewritten that same day.
But, I mean, you say that's an advantage. I think that's a disadvantage. You have more time to plan Raw than you do to plan NXT, because once that's set in stone when the tapings start, you can't change focus because you need to keep it cut to a certain amount of time. Raw, they have a whole week to plan this.
Yeah, that's the other thing. I mean, I think there's something to be said for the compartmentalization. Both Lucha and NXT have that. We're taping X amount, X weeks at a time, in a day, in 2 days, whatever the case may be. So you can lay out a plan a little easier long-term, that way.
Yeah.
Like, they're saying, we got to get through 3 hours tonight, and we're watching all 3 hours tonight. We're not taking these 3 hours and splitting them for the next 3-4 weeks. You know, I think that is part of the mentality too. And again, number of writers, we've talked about formats and what's going on backstage in the past. I mean, I think it's just a different beast. And I think much like we, you know, if you talk about like, I'm sorry, this is what I can compare it to. If you talk about other companies, like why is IBM not doing the things they need to be relevant these days versus why does something more nimble like an Instagram do all this stuff and it's more exciting? Like, the IBM is WWE these days. They're the old creaky corporate thing that can't move that quick. And your NXT Lucha Undergrounds are the Instagram startup-y fun guys that have an app on your phone and doing all the cool flippy stuff, right?
Yeah.
Does that work?
I see what you're getting at.
Yeah.
I think the format needs to change, you know, eventually, whether it is, you know, obviously we mentioned before about the whole, you know, there's Lance Sword, you mentioned like the reason they're doing 3 hours maybe because of, you know, pressure from like advertisers or whatever, you know, like it's a case of like, you know, the USA Network or whatever is sort of pushing that whole, you know, 3 hours thing. And I think NXT and Lucha are proving that the model can change. Like, it doesn't have to be the way they presented it, you know, for X number of years.
Right.
And I think they should also try and distinguish the Raw product a little bit more. Because I know the stage stuff is expensive. I know it is. But when you see the same stage on Raw that you do on SmackDown, that you do on the pay-per-views, that you do on Main Event, you do on Velocity, if you watch those shows, it just seems boring. It seems entirely boring. Like, look at Lucha Underground. It's set in a grungy, dirty temple. Like, it's essentially staged in an abandoned warehouse outside of LA. And yet, it is far more entertaining than like Raw and SmackDown. What would we do if Raw, just for 1 week, decided to not put the big stage up and have the old intro like back in 93 where they just had the big Raw letters of
oh man, Sabu's gonna jump off of it again.
120 inch monitor for the Titantrons and whatnot, and then just a simple walk down instead of a big ass stage.
And nobody can follow.
Oh, you mean You mean like they used to do before in special episodes?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like, those seem more fun because they're different.
Mm-hmm. They do. I think there's a level of that where, like, the aesthetic plays a factor. When you see the same set over and over and over again, it does get very tiresome. Like, it's it's like, okay, we're watching, like, all the shows blend together. You know what I mean?
Nothing seems special.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. It's just like, here we go again. I'm already finding myself bored with Ziggler and Tyler Breeze for like the third or fourth time. Mm-hmm. It's like all we know is the boom, boom, boom. You know, is to kick these together. I'm with you on that. There needs to be that distinction. But I also keep going around to, isn't this the perfect time for somebody that's not TNA that has something unique and has not Ted Turner level money, but enough to make it significant to run up against WWE,
gonna run up against WWE.
What's that?
No one's gonna run up against WWE.
No, because, well, why would you run up against WWE if WWE is like faltering at this point and nobody's gonna put money behind them because they don't see the business. The business isn't hot very very much. Everybody's picking up scraps of the wide business that is wrestling these days. You know, from your Inspire Pros to the Lucha Underground to WWE themselves, right? We're not all watching Raw. We're watching, as WWE fans, some of us are watching NXT, some of us are watching Raw, some of us are watching SmackDown, some of us are watching Smoky Mountain Wrestling, you know? I mean, like they've splintered their own audience at this point, and we all come together for WrestleMania. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. They've done it. So you're going to see Raw continue to fail until USA has a problem with it, right? And who knows how those discussions are already going. I mean, they already got less than what they wanted for the new deal for Sci-Fi, for SmackDown and Raw on TV through NBC Universal Comcast.
And SmackDown and Raw are going to both be on USA.
Right. Which
and that's going to stagnate even more.
Yeah, that's not going to help. That's not going to help at all. I think that's just. But still, until does that still affect their bottom line? Since they are still picking up pieces here and there with WWE Network controlling it, aren't we leading to a future maybe 5 years down the line where we don't even need the USA anymore? I think that's where they want to go. To be honest, is to extend out that way, and maybe we'll get to the point where your superstars main event. Jacked and Afterburn and Sunday Night Heat and Shock on Saturday Nights. That's what you're going to see everywhere else. But if you really want to see what happened on Raw, that's going to end up being WWE America. I think sometime within the next 10 years, Raw or whatever replaces Raw will just be on the network.
I think that was their original plan, but they couldn't get anyone to fund that.
I think that is a... Because right now, Raw and SmackDown push people to the network. Like, if nothing else, they're advertisements for the network, right?
$9.99.
I was this close to buying a $9.99 shirt, which is, by the way, $4.99 on WWE Shop.
Yeah.
Put that together. I thought that was a hilarious point there.
Happy Black Friday.
Happy Black Friday, guys.
Could I mention that Matt Carlin's posted in the Slack the WWE Fan Council questions they asked? Here are some of the examples of the question.
Should we all answer them, Bobby?
Yeah, if you want to. How often do people typically watch Raw?
Once a week.
Okay. What other streaming services do they subscribe to?
Like Netflix, I guess. HBO Go.
Yeah.
How often?
I don't see how that helps their. What there's like? Ask about the actual product.
No. This is
viewing habits have changed compared to the past.
Mike, you have to see this as the big thing. All the questions together, not just what does each question mean.
Yeah, I know.
Right?
How do they watch Raw live or DVR?
That's the interesting question, I think.
If
they check before Raw airs to see which superstars are appearing.
Which can you even
else
do that?
In the household watches Raw, or WWE. Reasons why they might fast forward or change the channel during specific segments.
I think that's one of the key questions that they should be asking.
If they switch over to Monday Night Football on ESPN, what segments they prefer, matches, angles, video packages, etc. If advertising matches ahead of time would make them tune into a specific hour. How they would rate the show overall and how much time they devote to watching one hour, 2 hours, or the entire show. And there's a big old ad for John Cena on shop.com.
Well, okay, can I just one more little bit and then we'll go to the next segment here. I just finished the documentary called Electric Boogaloo. Mm-hmm. Yes, because they're the ones that coined the sequel Electric Boogaloo thing. It was about Canon Films. It was one of the biggest B movie things. Actually, Rob, that does a video for us, helping us with cameras at IWCRWA, recommended it. It's on Netflix. And I was really fascinated as we were talking about this, and you were given that, because at one point they were talking about how they were just churning out all these B movies. And I look at wrestling storylines sometimes as a really quick, down and dirty B movie sometimes, right? Because there's no budget to it, etc. And I'm thinking about, like, there's a line where they're just putting out these movies and putting them out how they thought movies needed to be done, not what audiences actually wanted to see. And I thought that really kind of goes right along with what we're talking about here with WWE and listening to the audience. And we'll see where something like this survey goes, right? That's only one data point and can easily be dismissed if they don't like the answers. And I think that's what happens too much with this company. So.
One of those questions should have been, do you often ask, where's Randy?
There you go. Hey, stop bringing in jokes from other podcasts.
I know, I'm sorry.
Son of a bitch. There's inside jokes, and then there's outside jokes. Leave them outside.
I'm sorry. Leave that. Oh, well, sorry.
We are not talking. We are not the Talking We Watch Wrestling show, okay? Yeah, no. You are not Chris Hardwick.
Now on to our grunt of the night. That's from the Attitude Era podcast.
Oh, jeez. And I'm not an anti-advertising other podcast. It's just I realize, like, wait a minute. I've heard something like that. And I don't want people to think that's our gag.
Yeah, I know.
I don't even know what our gags are
anymore.
Actually,
it's not their gag either. It's a Simpsons gag.
Squisher?
Oh. No. And this is why Bobby.
But, I mean, this is kind of where we're at with Raw. We're bored overall with the overall. Like, TLC should be coming. TLC is coming up. We should be invested. We have a triple threat tag title match that none of us really care about because there's no reason to.
Can't wait for that state match.
I love a New Day.
You just care because you want the New Day to keep winning.
Who doesn't?
Can't wait for that Avengers match.
Amen. If they had replaced.
You're not wrong.
If they replaced the Usos and Lucha Dragons with the Dudleys and the Ascension, would you care any more or any less?
Yes.
Probably not.
More.
I want to point out though, through the night, first, like, New Day was so over last night. Like, to the point they were chanting New Day Rocks.
They're all over the show.
No. Let me paint the picture. They were chanting New Day Rocks in the in between Superstars matches in the Dead Space. New Day came out, and everybody was down with it, even when they insulted the Steelers, right?
Yeah, he wiped a terrible towel all over himself, and they were still over.
Yeah. And then the second time, and then the third time, and in the half an hour match, and then it just went off the edge, you know, which still them doing kind of good. But,
you know, this is the time where they should be pulling the trigger on something like that. Mm-hmm. Because there's nothing else going on.
Right.
There really isn't. Why
if
not
there
say,
wasn't...
all right, Roman Reigns beat Sheamus at TLC.
Yeah.
Either then or Royal Rumble. Give Big E Langston a title shot.
Oh, yes.
Just straight up give him a title shot against Roman Reigns. You have Roman Reigns trying to fight off the New Day. They can parallel it to people trying to fight off the Shield. It's a very simple story, and it involves someone who is over. Mm-hmm. Like, legitimately over.
I also want to point out Roman over last night.
And those side plates when he wins the championship are just of booties.
Yeah, booty. All right, guys. You know what is not booty? I think I'm using
what
that.
What is not booty?
I think I'm using that right. Am I using that right?
You are right.
Okay. Yeah, you're right. You know what's not booty? It's Slice on Broadway. They're not booty, and they're in Beachview right here along the tracks in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, or the Main Street in Carnegie, PA. Perfect pepperoni pizza supporting Pittsburgh podcasting for the last year and a half. Check them out, sliceonbroadway.com, if you want more information. Some fantastic videos. Look at that. Look at that. Some great stuff. That's some pizza really. That's some pizzeria sexy footage right there. Go check them out. They're right. They're supporting the podcast. It's delicious. It's from scratch. It's good stuff. It's PJH_Slice on the Twitter. It's Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and on the Instagrams. You'll get hungry. It's supporting the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Let them know you heard about them here. And go check them out. All right, guys. From that, first of all, Eamon here is going to duck out for a moment, and the Rizz is going to jump in here. So if you're not liking, like we said, the audience is split. You can find something on WWE Network from this era or last, right? And you know, we're enjoying Breaking Ground. I just watched the latest episode this morning. We're watching, Table for Threes. We're picking up. I'm watching old War Games matches. Oof, those are rough sometimes for the right and sometimes the wrong reasons. You're looking at this old stuff. And apparently there is some new stuff that popped up on the network. Rizz, what is new on WWE Network that you guys are really digging or watching lately?
Right now, they released, I believe, NWA WCW, mm-hmm. NWA era WCW, and they released Smoky Mountain Wrestling,
woo,
which I'll get into later. And I believe the other one was, what was the third one? Was it Mid-South? I think it was Mid-South.
Yeah, Mid-South, yeah.
And, oh my goodness, the mullets alone is worth the price of admission.
$9.99.
$4.99
if you're wearing a shirt.
And for some reason, Smoky Mountain Wrestling, WWE has a really, really big affection to the thrill seekers. Because each one of those ones that they put on there had some sort of match featuring the thrill seekers. Hmm. And they also had a nice young lady by the name of Tammy Fitch. I wonder what happened to that lady.
She moved.
Cyber Monday.
Yep. $100 for more. But they stopped at the hair versus hair match between. It was right after the scaffolding match, which Jim Cornette almost died from.
Oh, I watched that one.
Yeah. There was that. There was the one that was directly after that. So I saw like clips of that and brought back memories. But they just posted like matches you'd see from, like, if you were watching ESPN Classic, like mm-hmm. some of the squash matches, some of the cool things on there, some of the promos, which are awesome. And I've seen people watch the NWA WCW and think the same thing when they see the Ric Flair promos and all that. But Tracy Smothers is on there, and it just his presence alone makes me feel weird because I've seen him wrestle before, like now. so it seems weird seeing him and the partner that he was with, Bob Armstrong.
Oh, okay.
And then see the Bob Armstrong's son have an amazing mullet, like all the way down to his back. That's like the only thing I can think of right now. Bob Armstrong. The referee, yeah.
Scott.
Yes.
Called a Kentucky waterfall.
Yes. but if you guys, this is why I wanted to get the network from the beginning, because of the old wrestling. I mean, the pay-per-views and all that are cool. I mean, we're gonna have discussions about the pay-per-views being good and bad in the future, but the library is now expanding, mm-hmm. and that's why people wanted to buy it. That's why I fell for it. That's why the WWE Network, it's going to sound like Michael Cole on that one, WWE Network was a thing because of stuff from the past that we want to relive. And some people want to relive, you know, Tracy Smothers and who was it? Tracy Smothers, Bob Armstrong, and Road Warrior Hawk versus the Funks. But yeah, I just watched a few of the Smoky Mountain Wrestling, and I'm hooked already. So I'll be in a rabbit hole for next week for that one. That's the only thing I watched, though. Like, I didn't watch the Mid-South or NWA WCW yet. But...
I watched some of the NWA WCW stuff. I saw, like, I started in 85, and I actually, the second episode I watched had the infamous Hard Times promo from Dusty Rhodes, which was awesome to see, like, in that context, you know. One of my favorite moves from it is the Flying Burrito. That guy, I can't remember who did it. The move was awesome. The Boogie Woogie Man, that guy's Jimmy, awesome.
Jimmy Valiant.
Yep. Oh, yes.
With his street lady he found. He's like, some street lady come up to me.
Bobby.
Found my street lady.
Bobby, Manny Fernandez?
Manny Fernandez, that's who it is. Yeah.
Flying Burrito. Yeah,
the Flying Burrito. That's awesome stuff. It's just really cool things. Like, I watched, like, I think, like, 3 episodes. One of them I watched at 1 in the morning, and I got an achievement on my WWE thing on Xbox for Night Owl, which gave me 0 gamer points. But it was still cool to see, like, you know, like, just the past. And it's cool to relive that stuff. I never watched, like, WCW back in the day. I watched when Clash of the Champions come on because it was a free pay-per-view, basically, on TV, on the Superstation. Mm-hmm. And then I started watching WCW Saturday Night when it was on. But I wasn't a part of that, like, era. I didn't know NWA existed back then.
And it's weird now in hindsight to see, like, the topics that would be up for grabs on this one. Tammy Fitch. I'm going to call her Tammy Fitch.
She was Tammy Sitch in ECW.
Yeah. She went on like a nice little tangent about she thinks OJ is going to be guilty because she has the best lawyers. I'm like, okay. And then, like, the next promo was Jim Cornette just yelling about some sort of legal thing with, and he brought up Rodney King's beatdown. I'm like, wait, are they allowed to say that?
Topical.
And then I realized, oh, wait, this is 94. So it feels weird to say, like, oh, that's topical now. So it just felt awkward, but it felt good because they're supposed to be heels. And in 1994 in the South, yes, that worked. And that probably still works now, though.
In the South.
In the South.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In the South.
One of my favorite things, because, I mean, I haven't watched it on the network yet, but I've watched enough old NWA and Smoky Mountain and Mid-South just based on my time at WWE. And one of my favorite things that they don't do anymore, and they really should, is in the old NWA, the stage they have for the interviews, where, like, a lot of the famous Flair promos took place and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it would just spill from that interview stage, which was literally in front of the actual ring. That is my favorite thing. When you get the camera shot that's like pan out and it just shows they're like in a sound stage essentially. And you can see where the staging is set up, and then, oh, they could just go right to the ring and have a match and do an angle.
Like, Superstar Billy Graham was yelling from the stage at somebody. I can't remember who it was now, but it was hilarious.
Yeah, I mean,
I remember watching the Smoky Mountain when I was watching, and first it was the guy just sitting at a table with the microphone in front of the table talking to you about the match and showing you a clip from that match. And then another one is they were standing in front of that table yelling at each other and then leaving to go to the ring in the same spot. So that's the announce table. That's the interview desk. And that's the ring it. That's the ring entrance.
So
it's like when you watch old 80s game shows. Like there's a certain kitschiness to it that just makes it seem like a lot more fun.
So I have no idea if he's actually like watching the show at the same time here or something. But I just happened to look over at Twitter and Buddy Landell is talking about the exact same thing right now. He says one thing you get from watching Mid-South Smoky Mountain shows is how naturally good these guys were at promos. No writers, all off the head. And he says you can put those NWA shows with that too. Completely. There were not writers to the sense that we have them today in the scripts and everything.
But Sorg, do you want to know why those guys were really good at promos? Simple storytelling. Very simple storytelling. Like, if you had something that was just like, oh, this guy beat me up and caused me to lose my championship, I'm going to get back at him. And that's my motivation. Mm-hmm. That's my driving force. I can talk about that. But if you're, like, I don't know why Dolph Ziggler is fighting Tyler Breeze at this point. I don't know why. Dolph clearly is not broken up about losing Summer Rae.
The Rose Bush.
He's never mentioned it. He's never mentioned it.
Rose Bush.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that. But
no, let's not.
I mean, like there's no motive. Like, I forget where Vince said it, but I think it might have been on Austin's podcast. Like, he doesn't want to have wrestling for wrestling's sake. That's at least three quarters of Raw. It's at least three quarters of Raw. Like, why was Brie Bella wrestling Sasha Banks? Where's Natty? I thought Natty was shooting with Team Bad.
Natty party. At her, like, Natty party.
Like, we should have had an uneasy alliance with Natty siding with Team Bella against Team Bad. That's an interesting story. You can build something off of that because Brie and Alicia would be weird that Nikki's not there. And Natty wouldn't trust the Bellas because obviously they're the Bellas. Like, you just come back into simple storytelling. Like,
I can actually see that.
Like, back, do you know why the Attitude Era worked? If you watch Attitude Era matches, every match had a purpose.
Right.
The guys were not the best workers. They did not have the best promo skills in the world. D'Lo Brown, that's all I have to say. But anytime D'Lo was in a match, you knew why he was in the damn match.
Right.
Whether it was to keep his European title, to get back his European title, to hit someone with a chest protector, to hit someone with his European title. Like, you knew why D'Lo was in a match. But Neville. What is Neville doing? Neville literally has nothing going on.
Yeah, We're sitting there watching he was main eventing Superstars with Bo Dallas. And we're like, you know, Chachi's saying, like, I remember I watched these guys do a ladder match for the NXT title. I don't care to watch them on Superstars for no reason at all.
Right.
As good as they are. And you're right. You know, you're there to do he does the red arrow and yay, there we go. And we go home. You know, it's comparable to Zach Gowen. You book Zach Gowen so the fans see a one-legged man do a moonsault. That's it. You know?
But Zach Gowen had a believable storyline.
When he was in WWE. In
as the biggest Hulkamaniac.
Right.
He was attacked by Roddy Piper.
No. Like, I'm not saying his WWE time. I'm talking about on an indie. Like, you pick him up, have him in a match.
Okay, this happens.
Like, and that's what they're doing with Neville. They put him in a match to do the red arrow, and everybody goes home happy. That's it. There's no story. There's nothing. He has a cape, he's a dude that does a thing.
I mean, you can do that, but don't do it with guys who are established names on your roster.
Right.
Get jobbers. What is so wrong with jobber matches? They work on NXT a lot.
And they worked on, like, they worked on Mid-South.
Yeah.
They worked on Smoky Mountain. I saw a match with the Rock and Roll Express. They had a match with two guys in masks called the Infernos. I can't tell them apart. And they won in about maybe 5 seconds.
and it was great. So they don't, wait, how much do they have here? Like, I'm not seeing much of Mid-South wrestling.
Have, like, six for Smoky Mountain.
Okay.
There's a bunch for NWA.
Yeah, WCW. I see. Yeah, WCW has a ton over here.
Can I just mention another favorite thing about WCW, or the NWA WCW stuff? I love at the beginning of every episode, Tony Schiavone and David Crockett longingly looking into each other's eyes when they're doing commentary.
By the way, they just, I guess they just put up new, did they have AWA on here before?
That was the one they put up.
Yeah, they just put up that one on mine right now.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah, here it is. Here it is. Some AWA. They have, by the way, two episodes. Two episodes.
For those of you who have not seen AWA,
yeah,
just look for every Nick Bockwinkel promo.
Yeah.
So good. He, like, AWA, the matches to me when I was watching them were, quite frankly, a little boring.
Mm-hmm.
But Bockwinkel promos, oh. He was born the wrong time. He was born the wrong time.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, he would be crushing it now.
Yeah, Mid-South has four.
Yeah.
Four matches. Four.
And we got some,
I'm sure they'll add more,
we got
too.
The Midnight Rockers. What is happening here? What the heck? This is crazy. Is that like Jerry Sags? What is happening? This is so 80s. I love it. I love it. I think this is the thing that I put on when I'm like, yeah, I don't want to think right now. And here we go.
Like I said, this is what this is for us.
Early early Nasty Boys.
Groups.
The Nasty Boys.
Oh, it's so great. I can't wait.
Yeah, but this is for like the millennial groups who want to know more about professional wrestling.
Oh, come on.
Like
the millennials don't care about this, right, Eamon?
Well, he's
he doesn't care.
See,
about
he don't care
he
about
this
segment.
About conversation.
I didn't tell him to take a powder during this segment or anything to prove my point.
Disembodied voices.
Disembodied Eamon. Disembodied Eamon. Like, do you care about this?
Sure.
This sounds like a soundboard. Is this really Eamon?
Is it an Eamon soundboard? Yes, of course. Poopy diapers.
Wow. No, but I think one of the things we always talk about is the content being rolled out on the network and stuff like that. So yeah, it's cool that they have that out there now.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, go check that out. Let us know what you think. Are you watching some of it? I know Buddy Landell is, of course.
Buddy Landell's watching Buddy Landell.
Yeah.
Wasn't he in WCW?
He was in the NWA WCW.
Yes, he was. All right, guys. We're going to talk a little bit more, but in the meantime, hey, go check out IndieWrestling.us. We just got through a crazy Black Friday sale this past weekend. Thank you. A lot of people participating in that. A lot of people signing up for the newsletter. Thank you so much for that. Hey, if you sign up for the newsletter, IndieWrestling.us, you actually do get a free download of IWC's 100th event with guys like AJ Styles, Christopher Daniels, a whole bunch of people. I think the Sandman might be on that one too, or
Find
that might
Rizz.
Be too. Find Rizz in the crowd. So go over there, IndieWrestling.us, get that for free. Check out Around the Indies with Matt Carlins. The
just
Indie Mayhem Show is featured over there, and we're just starting. This is day one as we record this of the IndieWrestling.us Advent Calendar Sale.
It starts on my birthday.
Yes, it did. Because that's when every advent calendar starts,
yes,
is Bobby's birthday. Every day we will have a sale. Follow us on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook, the Indie Wrestling US Facebook, the US Indie Wrestling. Yeah, I think we flipped that on Twitter. And you'll get the sale every day from now through Christmas of one item on sale every day in digital download format. Today, for instance, if you're on it, if you missed it, with Advent, one is the coupon code. You are getting RWA's last show, Open Season 2015, for only $1.99. That included Flip Kendrick versus Amazing Red of all matches and so much more. What's going to be tomorrow? Who knows? Well, I know because I actually entered that for tomorrow. But you don't know! So follow all that kind of stuff. And we're going to be featuring a lot of things from the catalog all through the month of December. And we have a very deep catalog. Very deep. Very deep. IndieWrestling.us. Now let's take a look what happened last week at Sogatron Media. And we'll be back with the big birthday question from Bobby.
It's a purely notification device. That's what I like it for, you know, whereas the Apple device is more
it wants to do everything else.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah, this is just notifications. It does fitness tracking, which God knows I could use more of. Notifications and steps. It also does stairwells now, which it didn't. The last one didn't do.
I'm a freak for the WCW Cruiserweight Division. When I dig down and look at the original Heavenly Bodies and a lot of Simon Dean, obviously.
From the chat, Eamon is saying, push Big E, NXT, Kofi, fire Xavier, he will have a home at Inspire Wrestling. Hey guys, look, the crew is all here. It's the Wrestling Mayhem Show, and it's time for the big question, and Rizz is stepping in on this one.
And this one comes because today, if you guys follow us on Gold, we did a nice little birthday roast of one Bobby FJ Town, because it is his birthday today during this
it's
podcast.
It's your birthday, Bobby.
And one of the things we did last year, it was on Raw, because it was on a Monday.
Yeah, it was on a Monday.
We did an all positive edition of a Raw hangout, which lasted, 2 hours?
Maybe about 2 hours, yeah.
After that, Bobby just quit. So I want you guys to tell me and tell the Mayhem Universe, for Bobby's birthday, what are you most proud of in professional wrestling? What is your most positive thought about professional wrestling?
Like, generally?
Mm-hmm. As of today. It can be about indies. It can be about overseas. It can be about anything your heart desires. What are you most positive about? This is the closest we're ever going to get to a new day on the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Have we not learned anything from the new day? Let's be positive. Power positivity.
Okay.
P.O.P.
I
got
it
one.
Down. Mad Mike, hold it down.
I got one. I am proud of the fact. I got two things for you, Riz. Two things.
Two things
I'm super proud of.
No, don't address to me. Just to the birthday boy.
No, excuse me, Bobby. Bobby, I have two things.
Okay.
One you may not like, but I'm still damn proud of it.
Okay.
I'm proud of the fact that Titus O'Neil stole my wrestling Christmas song theme gimmick.
He blatantly stole it.
Titus, I know you listen. I know you've listened to the Christmas episodes.
He does follow me on Twitter, by the way.
Mm-hmm. This is what I'm saying.
He's too busy helping people.
He's the real proud dad of the year. But the other thing I'm proud of is I named a tag team in NXT, and that is the Hype Bros. I'm proud of it. Damn proud.
That made me very negative, but today's positive because it's Bobby.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Hey, Rizz, stay positive.
Rizz, stay hype.
Stay positive.
Okay, I got one.
You got one for your birthday, Bobby?
I got one for my birthday. I bashed this. There's two people I want to shout out to in NXT. Two people that I have badmouthed and bashed constantly. Okay? Those two people have won me over.
Hmm. Oh, no, Bobby, no.
Yes.
Don't.
I'm talking about Dana Brooke.
Yes.
No, Rizz.
Dana Brooke has won me over. Dana Brooke now. I am on the Dana Brooke hype train.
Bobby, you're exactly right. Continue.
The other person won me over because of one thing he said. I don't hate this person more than I hate Ryback now.
Get what Bobby said.
It's Mojo Rawley.
Yeah!
And you know why I like Mojo Rawley?
This positivity thing has gone off the rails.
Because on Breaking Bad...
Breaking Bad.
He was doing meth in the background.
That's why he's so hype, Bobby.
On Breaking Ground, when he was making fun of Baron Corbin for eating food. I've been saying this constantly. I go around saying, yeah, eat that food. Eat that food. It's so fun. I can't help it.
No, no, you guys don't understand. He does this.
I do.
All the time.
All the time. And I have to thank Mojo for that. Even though he may not be my favorite wrestler, I am learning to like him a little bit more. Same with Dana Brooke. I like Dana Brooke now. I loved her feud with Asuka. I love Asuka, though.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
He's the best.
I mean, yeah.
And I'm also happy that there are different types of wrestling besides Raw to watch. We got Lucha Underground. We got NXT. We got ROH. We got TNA to a certain extent. We got a couple other ones. I mean, we got all these, like we talked about, NWA, AWA. It's just wrestling's all over the place. Even though it may not be the most popular thing right now, at least it's starting. Like the fringe stuff is still a thing, and it's starting to catch on. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
that splinter, that fracturing, like I was talking about, man. That's it. Amen. What do you got? What is your positive thing going on right now?
Why are you positive today, sir?
Eat that food, Amen.
Hey, Men Rocks. Hey, Men Rocks.
The one I could think of most recently, when I was watching Raw with Bobby and Rizz, this came up. Of course, the New Day being awesome, doing what they do on commentary, telling us how Big E's his daddy, our daddy, but also our uncle.
Keep it tight.
And then. New Day leaves celebrating, and what do we immediately go to next? A Team Bad segment, or a Team Bad match. That's like the perfect like link of everything I love about pro wrestling, just one after the other. I'm very positive about that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, Sword, you want to take this one?
All right. He just reminded me. I kind of have a secondary one. I'm sorry. I'm so happy that the Gobbledygooker had the best Thanksgiving ever in the history of the Gobbledygooker last week. And also, Team Bad was part of the segment with New Day for the Thanksgiving last week. So there's that. Go watch SmackDown for that.
So it was the point.
It's worth it for what?
Anyway, funny was, remember? Adam Rosebud Rabbit Stew.
Oh, yeah. There was a Band-Aid in the cast. What the hell? But anyways... also, my positive thing is, man, we were kind of bumming. We're like, is this guy ever going to debut? Why is he a bicycling enthusiast? Yes. And then we found out the reason we haven't seen friend of the show Logan Shulo, now known as Elias Samson, the Drifter, for the last almost 2 years. This month that I interviewed him before he took off at his last independent show. It's because he's been freaking doing an album with Jim Johnston because the Drifter got a music video debuted this week, man. Check it out. It sounds good. It is great stuff.
I was overjoyed. I tweeted out IWC's all over the show. Oh, that was our ROH too.
Yeah.
But he favorited it.
And you know what? If you actually listen to the words of the Elias Samson song, he makes a lot of references to other people in NXT.
Yeah.
Like a lot of them. Mm-hmm. And I hope it's a series of things to come. Like he mentioned the Demon. I'm like, if we get an Elias Samson Finn Balor match out of this.
Because
that's how John Cena started. John Cena called out The Undertaker in his first theme song.
And finally.
Just saying, Cena used rap, Elias is using country, but work.
It's more folksy than country, folksy. I think. Yeah. I think it's more Bob Dylan than it is.
It's not depressing. It's not country. I guess.
Even though when
they do bring him up in WWE, they'll probably turn him into country.
Be my baby tonight.
Oh.
Spend my day working hard for the dough. Was that it?
I hate rap.
Wow. All I'm going to say is this feud with Heath Slater on Superstars is going to be amazing.
Amen.
That wasn't a knock.
You're right. But you had to say it was on Superstars.
Yeah,
you
listen.
One Man Band versus Heath Slater.
The Drifter in a one-man band. I mean, I think that'd be great. You know, that should definitely mid-card WrestleMania at least. Like, with a guest. Whoa. Okay, fantasy booking. You guys,
like Cyndi Lauper.
Heath Slater. Now, who's in the corner of the Drifter at WrestleMania?
Cyndi Lauper.
No.
Honky Tonk Man.
Wrong.
Oh,
wrong.
No.
Wrong.
Adele.
Oh, hold on. What's his fucking name?
Tennessee Lee.
Damn it.
No. Florida Georgia
Line. No. Garth Brooks' alter ego.
Chris Gaines?
Chris Gaines! That's who's in the corner.
Chrisley.
Carson Chrisley?
I do honestly wish it was Tennessee.
Chrisley does no best.
He just did the full double J.
Hold on now, everybody.
Anyways,
If Tennessee Lee came in, he would just try and marry Lana. Yeah.
Colonel Rob Parker.
Let's be fair.
So for me, I'm positive that we are in the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
With professional wrestling. Like, it may not seem like it, but it seems like they're trying to do something. Like, WWE's trying to do something. TNA, even though we make fun of it, they're trying to do something, even though it's not working. ROH try to do something. Lucha Underground is trying and succeeding in doing something.
NXT?
NXT is doing something. Is promoting everything going on right with wrestling. New Japan, even though the news that came out a few days ago was a little crappy, but they are doing so good.
Wait, what news? What news?
Hanma.
What?
We'll leave it at that.
Yeah, Hanma.
What?
So,
Hanma. Domestic abuse.
Okay.
Yeah.
But with New Japan World, I believe it's, and that's, by the way, ¥9.99, by the way.
Wrestle Kingdom 10 is going to be English commentary again.
So everything is moving towards wrestling being big again. Like right now it's on a lower step. And now it's starting its way back up that ladder.
Right.
So I'm just happy that it's, you know, coming. And yeah, we're going to have our downfalls. We're going to have bad things happen. We're going to have stupid things happen. We're going to have Vince McMahon things happen.
Vince things.
We take the good, we take the bad, we put them together what we have.
Facts of life?
Yes. So that's what I'm more most positive about, that we're going in the right direction right now. But that's pretty much an awesome New Day.
Ivy Tootie. I'm going to be Natalie. She was that one.
On the Twitters.
Whoa! Girls!
What?
Sword. Where can they tweet us at?
They can tweet us at Mayhem Show, like what's happening. Other than my discussion about which tremors were worthwhile that I'm having with
Tremors one and two, Sorg.
That I'm having with Miss Sinbin. But anyways, apparently Tremors, this has nothing to do with this show, but apparently Tremors, unpopular opinion, Tremors franchise is a masterpiece of feminist cinema, and I will fight anyone who says otherwise. So there's that.
Wait,
sorry, things are happening on Twitter. But anyways, Mainstream Matt, and it's in the wrong part. I'm positive about Lucha Underground Season 2, The Drifter, Sasha, and Wade Barrett in a Raw main event. There you go. Yeah.
At the same time?
And he also says, ain't waiting for Mayhem Mania, Elias Samson versus Heath Slater.
Book it!
Put it in.
I can't wait for Mayhem Mania this year. I'm so excited.
After we've figured out the rules, that first version.
Well, I think this year we should not allow anyone that's injured.
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not. But anyways.
Oh, that's gonna be hard.
I know.
That's like half the roster. They're gone.
No Randy. No Cesaro.
Nope.
Tyson Kidd.
Oh boy!
All right, that was
The glad power. We ended that on a positive
note. Way to bring it down, Bob.
Way to bring it back down to negativity. We have not learned anything from the new day. But what did we learn from wrestling this week?
We apparently need a lot of work.
Is it time?
I don't think it's time yet, is it?
Well, actually, I wanted to touch base on, because...
that was a good segue.
It was a good segue, if we're going to do that. But I want to have a little bit of discussion about this, because I'm seeing, a few different ways. Guys, are you buying Sheamus? A lot are talking, and I agree with, Sheamus is really kind of kicking ass as being the bad guy. Corpus Sheamus, I thought, went over really well this week on Raw, for being kind of thrown into something like this. You know, obviously Seth Rollins was probably supposed to be the guy, or maybe they were supposed to get here anyways with Seth versus Rollins. Maybe only the tournament part changed for all we know. But how are you guys feeling on Sheamus in this position?
They missed a big opportunity on Raw. They have that John Laurinaitis suit. they it's just white and red.
Yeah.
They missed the opportunity just to shine the huge bright light where literally all you will be able to see is WWE title. and maybe a tie.
I got Sheamus is nude. Oh no, that's just a suit.
But yeah, no, Sheamus is doing good. I mean, we've never when Sheamus is motivated, he can be a really great heel. Mm-hmm. He just hasn't had a story since he returned with fucked up facial hair, which we never got a reason for. It was just like, here's a new look for Sheamus. I assume it's just because that was his look when he was doing Rocksteady.
I don't think
but
it was.
But now he has a story. He's good again. Sheamus was great when he was the guy who just casually beat John Cena in TLC and was being the super heel about it. It's crazy how much our opinions of guys can change when they have motivation.
Mm-hmm. I just want to add, they almost made me want to purchase a Sheamus shirt last night. The Sheamus 515, it's just kicked your arse.
That's a great shirt.
It's awesome. I like it. There's nothing else to say. I like it. I hope it sticks around.
I probably am maybe the only one here, and correct me if I'm wrong, that's not fully in on this Sheamus thing. I don't know. I just feel like there, from a guy who, you know, earlier this year was wrestling in Kiss Me Arse matches, and even the day he won the championship doing stuff where he was trying to act like Hood or whatever with the New Day. Yeah. And losing to Ryback and one of the Lucha Dragons and one of the Usos. Because he has a belt and now that he's just kind of being a jerk or whatever, I don't know. I feel like there needs to be more work put in as far as, that goes. Maybe he'll get there eventually. Mm-hmm. For me, but I don't think 2 weeks of him just kind of being a jerk or whatever, is made him any different.
They have time.
Right.
They have a lot of time to build his character.
They have as much time as they want Roman to not have that belt. Mm-hmm. So if they want Roman to have that belt at TLC, they don't have a lot of time. But if they're waiting till Rumble or Fastlane, they got plenty of time.
I think they're waiting for a big pay per view. Mm-hmm. They're waiting for whenever the majority of the 6 month or the year contracts are up for WWE Network. So they want to get that money because it is all about that money. But
I don't think that's a big issue anymore because they're doing month to month. They're doing month to month now. You can literally buy 1 month of the network.
Yeah, there's no contract anymore. That's not an issue. They're trying to get your money from month to month. That's why you get the next pay-per-view pretty much lined up at the pay-per-view before. So they know you're going to drop the other $9.99 to make sure you see it. And that's why you get your packages of, this is what's coming up. This is breaking ground from next week. There's a show. We haven't even filmed that with Edge and Christian. That kind of stuff. I mean, that's the hey, stick around. Here's what's coming up, you know, kind of thing.
And going back to the Sheamus question, I like Sheamus being the heel because he is playing a heel. Nobody likes him. Nobody really likes him as champion, which means he's doing a damn good job being goddamn.
Oh, wait. I just got a weird deja vu. Did we just have the same conversation about somebody like a year ago?
I think we did.
Like, this is sounding really familiar. But
About Sheamus.
Probably about Sheamus. But I
probably,
but
that's the thing. It's like, I don't know. I don't think you can write off, like, people not enjoying a character as heat. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's kind of, you know, just to say, oh, this person's got heat because the crowd doesn't like them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like, that doesn't, you know, they're not getting heat necessarily by anything that they're actively trying to do to get heat. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Like,
he's doing a good job.
It gets down to, like, when a fan, not like us, Smart Mark, whatever's, but when a fan doesn't like Sheamus, they detest Sheamus. Like, they hate the sight of him. Yes. They're not entertained by the fact that they're being made to not like him like us. They're like, no, boo that guy. You look stupid. Screw that guy. He shouldn't be in the ring. Like, that is the conversation. It's like a Steelers fan talking about the Browns, okay? They personally detest the Browns. You know,
I mean, did you see that block kick though?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Browns
with the sports
did the most
ball.
Browns thing of all time.
Yeah. I think it's hard to compare football and wrestling in that case because I think it also comes from the fact of, like, people detest someone like Sheamus, maybe, for example, because they think it's boring.
The outcomes are predetermined.
They think his matches are boring.
But no, but they're not. But not just the matches. I mean, they're not supposed to get into his matches. They're supposed to get into the fact that they're being made more and more to hate Sheamus. So they'll get into the idea of Roman eventually beating him or trying to and ridding him on or wherever that leads to. That's not, we're not supposed to like Kevin Owens. We're not supposed to like Sheamus. We're not supposed to like Seth Rollins. We're weird. Okay.
I'll say people are still supposed to be invested in those matches though.
Right.
Like they're still supposed to be, you know, they don't need to cheer Sheamus when he does a cool move or anything like that, but Sheamus needs to, you know, create compelling matches to where, you know, they want to see Sheamus lose in the sense of, you know, but you can still want to see someone lose, but it's still compelling, you know what I mean? There's a difference between that and Randy Orton wrestling Sheamus and them having a boring match. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. All right. Well, on that point, let me know. What'd you learn from wrestling this week? Birthday now, boy, do you want to go first?
I guess so. I can go first. I learned that I had a lot of fun last night making up things for Roman Reigns to save.
Oh?
or like making up things like tweeting out Justin Timberlake will make new music if Roman Reigns can beat Sheamus in 5 minutes and 15 seconds.
Fox will bring back Firefly.
Yes.
If Roman Reigns can beat Sheamus in 5 minutes, 15 seconds.
Jar Jar Binks will be digitally added into The Force Awakens unless Roman Reigns can beat Sheamus in 5 minutes and 15 seconds.
Bobby, he's already there.
That's going to be
Kylo Ren.
Yeah. Spoiler alert.
Gross, Mike.
Misa, I made you any.
But I learned that I had a lot of fun doing that last night, and I want to thank Roman Reigns for at least giving us that. So thank you.
Tremendous, tremendous. Eamon, what'd you learn?
I learned from wrestling this week that, man, Cal Bishop has the worst life, you guys.
Aww. He made me sad.
He's literally just like, I'm starting to feel better, you know, I'm going to do some more stuff in the ring, and he's like, oh, by the way, you're fired.
Yeah. Wait. The
reaction to that was priceless, though. He's like, everybody's like, you're getting a raise, you're getting a raise, you're getting a raise, you're getting a let go. He's like, what? That was his reaction.
I'm so sad. But you saw it coming a mile away. Yeah, poor guy. But that's, hey, man, that's the biz, right?
Yeah.
Anyways.
Eat that food.
Man, Mike, what'd you learn? Other than eat that food.
I learned that TNA booked this tournament so that Pope could have one match where he makes nothing but He-Man versus She-Ra jokes. And my explanation for this is because Eli Drake has been dressing like He-Man, Pope has been calling him the Prince of Eternia, and he is wrestling Mahabali She-Ra. So we will have He-Man versus She-Ra. And yes, this was a thing I said maybe a month ago, maybe 2 months ago, maybe 5 years ago when this tournament started. And I'm like, we're not just doing this, so we're going to get He-Man versus She-Ra jokes, are we? And it turns out that's exactly why we're fucking doing it.
Yeah, eat that food.
Wow.
Wow. Where are we at? Rizz. Rizz,
in case you're wondering how good TNA's been, boom!
Rizz.
I learned how one segment can make me so happy and so proud and then so uncomfortable in mere minutes. I'll give you the actual thing here. The Miz TV for Monday. Rusev comes out, mm-hmm, and introduces Lana. But before he does, he mentions that he stops and argues with the crowd and going, "We love even harder," and just pauses so you can get that image in your head of Rusev and Lana doing it.
And yeah, then, eat that food.
Yeah, Rusev probably did.
Sorry, I didn't. It was there.
And then when Lana comes out, they talk about, they just went back and forth about how much they love each other and how much they, and then they showed the picture of Rusev proposing to Lana in bed while Rusev was shirtless, and it was freaky on that one. And then what even made it worse was the guy that interrupted him was Tinder expert Ryback coming out and talking about Dolph Ziggler going all the way with her, and it made me feel so uncomfortable for True Love.
I picture Ryback in the back going, "Tell me more, tell me more."
But does he have a car?
It was very uncomfortable.
Also, they used that picture again with Adam Rose, and they digitally put a bra on Rusev. Which that's unnecessary.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mike. Did you mean Bad News Rose?
Hey, Rose by any other name still has a shitty gimmick, Amy. All right?
Yeah. Yeah, somebody said that was the Tim and Eric directed portion of Raw.
Hey, but you know what? No, hold on. Before we get to what Sorg learned, Mick Foley said in his little manifesto thing that he said the guys in the Attitude Era were allowed to try and fail. Someone did read that part.
Mm-hmm. Oh, they tried. And yes. Oh, they failed.
Oh, yeah.
They took his tag team partner away, though.
Why don't we just do Leo Kruger again? Why don't we just do that?
Because Leo Kruger wasn't connecting with the fans.
Oh, and this is.
Right. That's a whole other conversation.
I really connected with a dude that wears blue plaid and just doesn't like stuff. Like, that's really, I can sympathize with that.
Blue plaid?
Is it blue plaid or whatever? I don't know. He's got a weird outfit now.
I don't know.
Because he's the party pooper.
Party pooper. All right, what did I learn from wrestling this week? I learned that the sweet is nice at Costco.
Look who's a highfalutin
sword with like champagne out of a golden chalice sword.
Man, one day.
Were you eating Cheetos out of a goblet?
One day we'll have the Wrestling Mayhem Show suite at Console Energy Center, and we'll all be hanging out. And then we'll get promptly kicked out because we'll probably throw stuff at the guys next to us. But anyways, what did I learn?
Sweet Life was Sorg and Missy. Coming soon to Disney XD.
What?
I don't know. I
don't know.
I don't.
It's a show. It's a show.
Okay.
Sweet life.
I learned that Mark Madden is relegated to row two. so we're watching. So we you always catch Justin LaBar at the Pittsburgh shows in the front row. One, Roman Reigns spilled his beer. So he was upset about that. I have to listen to his Trib radio show and see, because he was ranting when I ran into him outside that he's going to use his pulpit the next day about that. But I'm like, how does Mark Madden get like row two in that situation at a WWE show? But there you go. I'm sorry, not very exciting of a thing I learned.
Because mostly people will go, wait a minute, isn't that WCW announcer Mark Madden?
I know. By the way, probably paid for his tickets. So, but I don't know. Maybe that's the difference. Because I know LaBar was doing press stuff along with them at Children's Hospital all day. They didn't cry this time. Thank you for not reminding us about Connor yet again and making Pittsburgh cry.
Wait, they didn't show that?
His little brother.
Did they show? They don't think they showed anything.
No, they didn't show anything.
No, and they did a lot of stuff. They did a lot of stuff over there about that. There is a video online.
Okay, that was our local news station.
The local news had it. I think there's a video online about it. You'll probably see something on SmackDown. Maybe they'll show it next week. I think they just generally didn't have the video ready for something like that, since it was taken like all day for stuff. So
they were too busy putting everybody in the main event.
Yeah, seriously. But anyways, and there was always like also the thing I have not learned, but the thing I question is, Ryback the guy you want to put in front of a small, frail, sick kid? It's kind of an imposing
figure.
Well,
I don't know. Has that kid read The Secret?
Good point. I'll leave you on that. Guys, it's been a lot of fun. As usual, Wrestling Mayhem Show, WrestlingMayhemShow.com, live.WrestlingMayhemShow.com every 9 p.m. Every 9 p.m. Eastern time, every Tuesday.
Every 9 p.m.
All the 9 p.m. Also, Wrestling Wrestling
None
Mayhem Show, WrestlingMayhemShow.com, at Mayhem Show on Twitter, Facebook, Google Plus. No, that forget Google Plus. Facebook groups, a lot of conversation happening over there. And of course, please subscribe to us on the iTunes, YouTube, Stitcher, Twitter, all kinds of places, video and audio formats. Patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow if you want to support us monetarily, or please just share the show with a friend or an enemy if you think they'll like it. Maybe you don't like the show. Me, a frenemy. We'll be frenemies. And all that stuff. Thank you so much. The birthday boy, Bobby FJ Town of InsertCoinToBegin.com.
It was a fun evening.
The man with the former employer at WWE, at MadMike4883 on the Twitters from Poughkeepsie, New York.
Yeah, it's been a good week, Sork.
What?
It's been a good week. It's been a good week.
And of course, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, Eamon, at Eamon2 Please on the Twitters, joining me momentarily for Indie Mayhem Show with Metho Mofo from the RWA.
Yes, indeed. I'm very excited. It's been a good week.
Also, the Rizz of Rizz Plays Games and InsertCoinToBegin.com's Boss Battle as well.
Speaking of boss battle and video games, or this was in our Facebook group. WCW versus NWO World Tour was released today in 1997.
Hot damn!
I was 17 years old.
Hot damn!
That was from Kyle. I was from our Facebook group, Kyle.
Gonna have to fire that up. Was that the PlayStation or the N64 one?
N64.
As the N64 one. Or, versus the World was the PlayStation.
One of the WCW Thunder.
Mm-hmm. What? No. Not
good. I played
good.
That game a lot.
Not good. Man, I remember I was really impressed by WCW Nitro on PlayStation, and then I got the N64 version like last year, and I'm like, ooh, what did I see in this? But anyways, I'm sure it was an upgrade from, you know, WrestleMania challenge. Thank you everybody for joining us. Everybody in the chat room all night. Buddy Landell, Wheels, and so much more all night long. for being part of the conversation, being part of the vibe around here. Thank you so much. I am thankful for you guys. I know I didn't get too much into it last week from a lot of things, but I am thankful for the Mayhem Nation that's got us so close to 500, and I'm looking for 500 more because stuff from this. I love it. I love it. Thank you so much. Mayhem out. Wait, just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Just wait. Wait for the perfect time and attack. Don't give up what you want. Take it back. Wait for the perfect time. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.